thank you so much for coming down here. My first question is, what do you know now that you wish you would have known then?
I know there are a lot of cliche answers, like worry less, be in the present more, all of which are true. But I think that the one thing as actors, writers, directors, you're first and foremost artists. And when you go out there, you begin to worry about career. And I think what I wish somebody would have told me is the more I focus on the work, the more the rest will take care of itself. And I wish somebody had said that to me.
No one did.
No, and you know what? The truth is that I started my own theater company and I did my own thing. So in a way, I kind of did that. I kind of did the work and the rest followed. But I did spend a lot of sleepless nights thinking about, oh, why don't I have an agent? Or why don't I have this? And why don't you just... Steve Martin says, all you have to do is do the work so well that nobody can ignore you. And I think that's really, that's what I wish somebody had told me. Because it would have prevented me from worrying about things that I shouldn't have been worried about.
What can the theater do that only the theater can do?
I think when people ask that question, usually the reply is, well, it's the live presence of the actor, right? That you are in the room and you're breathing the same air that the actor is breathing, and that intimacy with an artist who's creating a live performance in front of you, something you can't get anywhere else. And I believe that's true, definitely, but I don't think that's the only thing. The reason why I always ask that question, what can you do in the theater that you can't do anywhere else, is because I started our theater company because I was very disappointed and disillusioned with so much of the theater that I saw in the country. And most of the theater that at that time you were seeing in New York and around the country was kind of kitchen sink realism, right? So there was always a sofa on stage, and there was often a sink on stage. And whenever there was a sink on stage, you could bet that at some moment it would open and water would actually come out of it. Yeah. And I was so bored with that. And I thought, that form, theater and film, film and television do so much better, right? Film and television is really good for realism or naturalism because it can do a close-up, and in an actor's face, you can see so much of the story. Mm-hmm. So to me, the question is, the answer to the question, what can theater do that nothing else can do? The answer is that which is theatrical. I mean, what is theatricality? How does the theater speak?
And can you teach that?
Yes, and can you teach that? And can you develop that? And can you do work? You know, the example I always use is Tom Stoppard tells the story of a production that he saw of The Tempest, right?
Oh, Ariel. This is the Ariel?
Yes.
Oh, good.
And then Ariel, it says, Shakespeare wrote, Ariel exits, right? And it was a production that was outdoor, and there was a set, a stage, and upstage of the stage was a lake, and upstage of the lake was a forest. So the audience is sitting where I'm sitting, there was a stage, a lake, and a forest. And it says, Ariel exits. And Ariel turns around, she finishes her line, she turns around, starts running up stage. You think she's gonna jump in the water, but she continues running and she runs on the water. So the set designer had put these planks inside the lake that the audience couldn't see. So she's running, she runs through the water, she gets into the forest. And then when she gets into the forest, the audience begins to lose sight of her. She hides behind a tree, and from behind that tree, fireworks erupt. So all of a sudden, Ariel has gone from being on land to walking on water to becoming fire. So to me, that's something that theater can do that nothing else can do, right? What are the theatrical vocabularies where we can explore everything that the theater can do? And I think that to me has been at the question of 20 years of the Laboratory of Tectonic Theater Project, and it has been at the core of plays like The Laramie Project, Gross Indecency, 33 Variations, I Am My Own Wife, Tallest Tree in the Forest now. So this is at the core of, that's the one question that we keep asking.
How did you come upon that question?
Well, I grew up in Venezuela.
Yes.
And at the time, Venezuela had one of the most important international theater festivals in the world. And I grew up seeing the work of real theatrical geniuses. I saw the work of Peter Brook and Tadeusz Kantor and Jerzy Grotowski and Pina Bausch and early Richard Foreman and some of Andre Gregory's early stuff. So I grew up seeing all this experimental work. The first time I saw a realistic play, I thought to myself, this is so avant-garde. There is an actual sofa on stage. And I think that I had the same experience that Moscow audiences had in 1898 when they first saw The Seagull, right? That all of a sudden Masha comes in and she sits with her back to the audience.
Yeah.
And everybody who was in the theater that night was embarrassed, alarmed, shocked that somebody would sit, an actor would sit with their back to them, you know? But what's interesting is that Chekhov himself, you know, in The Seagull, the famous Stanislavski production, says at the beginning, there's the sound of a horse carriage and the sound of wind, and you can hear the pebbles in the stream, and you can hear birds chirping and all of this. And then some, and it was, you know, the sound design of that production was still to this day very famous. 5 years after The Seagull opens in Moscow, this is, I don't know if it's an apocryphal story, but I've heard it enough times to believe that Chekhov said it. Chekhov says, I'm writing a new play. An actor comes on an empty stage. He looks straight in the audience's eye and he says, listen, I don't hear the wind. I don't hear a river. There are no birds. It's just you and me in this black house. So that he himself was already tired of the kind of realism and naturalism that he had helped give birth to. So from that I learned two things. Number one, that realism in its own moment was a great radical departure in form. But
from this kind of acting.
Yeah, from the declamation and declamatory acting, right? And you see that it has evolved and evolved, both the acting technique and the way a theater relates to its audience. So I think that's one of the things. When I started doing theater in Venezuela, I started as an actor working with a director who had studied with Peter Brook. And you know, whenever they do an international theater festival, the directors do workshops. Mm-hmm. So the theater makers in Venezuela had been trained mm-hmm. by Peter Brook and Grotowski and Kantor mm-hmm. and Pina Bausch and all, mm-hmm. in workshops, I mean, not, you know. Mm-hmm. So there was a very rich theatrical vocabulary. So I don't feel like I invented anything. I feel like I am a product of the Venezuelan theatrical world. And then when I came to New York, the place where that was being done a lot. And by the way, this, you know, the new school had played a very important role in the development of theatrical vocabularies of the 20th century, because Piscator, Irving Piscator, who was Bertolt Brecht's teacher, came here and taught here for many years. So this is hallowed ground where you're studying. And so when I came to New York, I went to the Experimental Theater Wing, because that's where a lot of these questions were being posed. And I was there for 3 years, and after that, the dean of the school, who always came to see everything I directed and was very complimentary, his name is Arthur Barto, the great Arthur Barto.
Yeah.
I went to him and I said, okay, I'm graduating, so I want to write and direct, how do I do that? And he said, Moises, you have to create your own theater company because nobody's going to hire you. And I said, but Arthur, I thought that you liked my work. He said, I loved your work, but you're doing experiments. And the way theater is in America right now, nobody's gonna pay you to experiment. You're gonna have to create your own vocabularies and your own laboratories where you can develop your own work. Best advice anybody gave me. Like, I walked out of the office and I was devastated, right? Nobody's gonna hire me. He kept speaking, all I heard was nobody's gonna hire me. But then giving it some thought, that's what I did. I created Tectonic Theater Project.
How did that happen? Out of whose group? How'd you get your cast?
It started with, like, I'm sure this is what's going to happen to a lot of you when you leave here.
It's hopefully.
With a lot of my peers at the school, and people who had the same kind of questions that I had. And we started doing theater in places that were like the size of that table, that platform.
Was this in your apartment where you had a fold-up table?
Yeah. Oh, my God. You really...
No, but you have to tell that story.
Well, we were very fortunate because we didn't have any money, but we found a rent control apartment, and we had a living room and a dining room, and in the dining room, my boyfriend and I had a fold-up table. and we would fold the table, and we would rehearse in the dining room, and then we would make the table again and eat there, usually with everybody in the company. So after we had our first success, like three and a half years in, when we did Gross Indecency, and it did very well, and it became one of the most performed plays in the country at that time, and we made a little money.
You know Gross Indecency, what it's about, the trials of Oscar Wilde?
Gross Indecency, trials of Oscar Wilde. I got home one day and my boyfriend had bought this gorgeous, really beautiful, thick wooden table, like gigantic, really thick, really heavy. And he says, you like it? I said, yeah, I love it, but where are we going to rehearse? And he said, exactly. No more rehearsing in my house. The theater company has some money, go find a rehearsal space. we still have the table.
I love that.
And we still have the theater company.
Yeah, good,
so.
Yeah.
It's a fortunate coincidence.
Yeah.
But you know, the first 3 years were very difficult. We started by doing a lot of work by authors who were themselves exploring theatrical forms. So we did a lot of Beckett, mm-hmm. we did a lot of Brecht, we did mm-hmm. a lot of Sophie Treadwell, mm-hmm. we did a lot of contemporary American playwrights, we did German playwrights. And those 3.5 years were the best times and the worst times. Mm-hmm. Many times we had more actors on stage than audience members in seats, even when we were doing two-character plays. I remember once we were doing a two-character play, a Kreutz play called The Nest, and we had one person come. So there were two actors on stage, but only one audience member.
But you did the play.
And of course we did the play.
And she loved it.
And she loved, not only did she love it, she ended up being Anne Cattaneo, who was the literary manager of Lincoln Center.
Yeah, for you.
And
Oh my God.
So, you know, you never know who's out there. I sent Richard Foreman a note after I saw one of his plays. We had never met. I said, Richard, I'm such a huge fan. I loved it. I was there last night. And he wrote me a card back that said, Moises, this is what we never know who's out there in the dark.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
We never know who's out there in the dark. And that's one of the things that makes it so thrilling.
Yeah.
You never know who's out there in the dark.
I love that. What nurtures collaboration and what are some of the conflicts you've had?
And a lot of what we do in our company is that we think of everybody who's in the room as a theater artist. I think in America, we tend to over-divide things, right? So we have the lighting designer, and we have the set designer, and we have the costume designer, and we have the writer, and we have the director, and we have the actor. And we have to remember that all of those titles are very recent in the history of the world, right? And if you look at that form, it's a form that it's very good for capitalism. It's a very, very economically savvy form, right? So you have a play, right, who's one person, she goes into her room, and we all have this image of what that room looks like, of the playwright's room, full of cobwebs and empty vodka bottles, right? And she spends 20 years there, she writes her play, she comes out with the play, she goes into another room, she gives it to the director, and the director has 3 weeks of rehearsal, 1 week of tech, and the play is up. Articulated in that way, you can see that it's a flawed form. So to me, the question is, if you're really rigorously questioning what can happen on the stage, it's really important to ask how what happens on the stage is made. So this idea of coming with a group of actors, designers, writers, directors, all in a room, and forgetting your title and creating together is something that can be incredibly rewarding. You know, when I turned to the actors of the company and I said, we're gonna go to Laramie, and we're gonna talk to people of the town, and we're gonna write a play about it. In that first trip, there were actors, there were designers, there were writers, there were directors, 10 of us, we all went to Laramie. And most of us had never conducted an interview before.
I was gonna ask you about that. How did you prepare the actors slash people to interview? Did they know anything about it?
No, but what we did, and this is the thing about collaboration, is that usually collaboration profits from two things. Having a very strong sense of purpose and a sense of a north. So when we went to Laramie, I knew that I didn't want to tell Matthew Shepard's story. And I knew that I didn't want to tell the story of the perpetrators. And I didn't want to tell the story of the past. I wanted to tell the story of the town. So we were going to go there to see what happened to the town of Laramie. And it came out of a profound belief on my part that theater artists are particularly adept at doing this kind of a journey. Why? Because most theater artists, but especially actors, what we deal with is empathy. What we are always training about is empathy. When you play a character, your most important tool is empathy. Can you empathize with what that character is playing? When you're playwriting, can you empathize with what the, when you're directing, when you're designing, it's all about empathy. We are experts in empathy. So I thought, if we take that empathy and we go to another town that has been severely bruised and severely hurt, can we, as a company of theater artists, talk to them and hear something? Yeah. And gather a document that hopefully records not only what was happening in Laramie at the end of the millennium, but what was happening in America at the end of the millennium. Hopefully, not only about homosexuality, but about religion, about education, about violence, about spirituality, about masculinity, about gender, about all of these kind of fault lines that are dividing us as a culture. And so what we did is we gathered in my apartment around that table that still serves a purpose, very much to my husband's concerns. And basically what we did is we came up with a questionnaire, right? So if in collaboration, it's important to know what's the North. The North for us was, we want to hear what happened to this town. The town was going to be the central character of our play. And so we came up with a questionnaire of, I think, 20 or 30 questions of that kind of elicited from the town. Tell me, how was Laramie before this happened? How was life here? What did you love about Laramie? What annoyed you about Laramie? Well, you know, so the before Matthew. Then we got into the Matthew Shepard questions. When did you first hear about the attack? Where were you? Where, and everybody was like, one of those things, when an event of that magnitude happens, you always remember where you were when you heard it.
Yep.
When did you hear it? What happened? You know, there, we knew there was an arraignment. Did you go to the arraignment? After the arraignment, what happened? The media from all over the country descended. The media made Laramie into the hate crime capital of America. Then Matthew Shepard died. What happened after the death? Immediately they wanted to put the two boys on trial. So we made a whole questionnaire of like 20 questions. And then we went into a rehearsal room and all of the actors interviewed one another. And that way we trained to do that. And then what we did is once we were in Laramie, every night we would get together and we would tell each other, not what we found out, because we were saving that for New York, but we told each other what we had learned about the art of interviewing. We had faltered and where we had succeeded.
And do you remember some of those?
Well, the most important thing is that we're in a culture that loves to speak and doesn't know how to listen. And so what would happen is that you would start asking somebody questions, and as soon as they began answering you, you would speak over them. Or you would ask them a question, they would start their answer, and you wouldn't wait for the end, and then you would finish their sentences. So first we stopped doing that, but then something else happened. We have a very hard time with silence. So if an interviewee would pause to think, we would feel we're not being good interviewers, and we would immediately jump in with the next question. When we were listening to the tapes, you would hit yourself. You're like, fuck, shut up. Let them fit. What's about, something else is about to happen. And you just broke that person's train of thought. So we learned that. And what happened after that was amazing. Because then, if you shut up and there's a pause, invariably, the text that comes after the pause is a pearl of great beauty. Because what has happened is that the person has gone a level deeper into their thinking and into their experience and into the way they are addressing the topic. So that was, so those are some of the things that we learned. You know, and then there's just some other practical things. Don't conduct an interview next to a train station.
That's there at a train station?
Next to a train station.
Because it's not so loud. Okay. What is the moment work and how did it happen? The moment work.
So moment work is a technique. Now you worried me because you were saying that Uta Hagen never liked the word technique. And I think I understand why. It's a problem, this idea of technique.
Well, it gets embedded. It's
Yeah.
you're identified and it doesn't keep fluid or something.
But it's interesting because we've been asked repeatedly, is moment work a technique or is it a method? Or, and I don't know if it's either. I think it's a series of exercises that we use to create work. And it was moment work was born out of this rejection of realism and naturalism, right? Because this form that I articulated before, right, that a playwright goes into a room, writes a play, comes out, it's gotten even worse now because so many of our playwrights that we're teaching at colleges and universities, the way they show their work always at first is in readings, table readings. There's nothing less theatrical than a table reading. You're teaching playwrights how to write for table readings. You're not teaching them how to write for the theater. And the tools that make a play successful around a table are character and conflict, which of course are very important. But those are dramatic elements, not theatrical elements.
Mm.
So moment work departs from the premise that we can write theatrical narratives, right? So imagine that there's a chair on an empty stage. And on that chair, there is a wedding dress. And imagine that a guy comes in to the wedding, to the stage, and looks at the wedding dress and slowly caresses it, right? That's a theatrical narrative, right? It's not a textual narrative. We haven't said a single word, but there's a whole huge story that's begun to be told, right? There is a great director, his name is Robert Lepage. He did a piece called The Seven Streams of the River Ota. And it was a 7-hour piece that takes place in 7 different continents. It's a beautiful, beautiful piece. It deals with the Holocaust and with AIDS and with the atomic bomb. It's a magnificent piece about, you know, the last 50 years in the last century. And each scene takes place in a different city, but there's one thing in common, and that is that all of the characters are related. Like all of the characters, it's one family basically. And there is a wedding kimono. It begins in Hiroshima. A woman is about to get married, but because of the bomb, the wedding has been called off. And there's this beautiful yellow kimono. And that yellow kimono manages to find its way to different places, you know? And so each person in the family wears it. At the end of watching that play for 7 hours, and the kimono has been at one moment in each 7 place, the wedding kimono has been there. The last descendant of this whole family is a performance art artist living in New York who's studying butoh. And he's preparing for a butoh performance, and he gets up and he puts on the wedding kimono, and he's a beautiful dancer with a great dancer's body. And the wedding kimono is built so that you don't see the edges of the fingers. And it also has a gigantic collar that goes all the way up to here. So the butoh performer goes like this and puts on the wedding kimono, and he turns around. So when he turns around, he's completely covered. When he turns back, inside the kimono is his grandmother. And he turns around again, and inside the kimono is his father.
Oh, wow.
And he turns around again, and inside the kimono is his lover. And he turns around again, and inside the kimono is him. And to me, so the question, how do we speak theatrically? As a playwright, I can write 4 pages of when a piece of costume goes from generation to generation, it captures something so profound about the essence of, right? Or I can do that. I can do very sophisticated discourses using the elements of the stage, right? How do we use that? How do we engage the audience's imagination in constructing narratives that are sophisticated, rigorous, entertaining, full of humor and life? I don't know, what was the question?
I don't know.
Okay.
Doesn't matter.
Moment work.
Well, we did a little bit of it this morning in our collab. It's just beginning to.
So moment work starts always with what's on stage. So you always start creating moments with a prop or with a piece of costume. You know, we talk about what are the elements of the stage. So yes, sets are the elements of the stage. Costumes are the elements of the stage. But also virtuosity is an element of the stage. Humor is an element of the stage. Yeah. The subversion of expectation is an element of the stage.
Boy, what do you mean by that?
That virtuosity, you can
subversion of...
Subversion of expectation. Is that you can, in a narrative, create an expectation and then subvert it. And that's uniquely, that's theatrically delicious.
Yeah.
So, you know, there are infinite elements of the stage. If you're working with a circus company, the elements of the stage are flying trapezes, you know? So that's what moment work is. It's a technique to create work using the elements of the stage. So that you begin by writing theatrical narratives as opposed to writing text.
Writing text, right.
And that doesn't mean, I want to be very clear, that doesn't mean that we don't deal with text.
No.
All of our work has a lot of text. But, you know, in the 70s and 80s, there was a large movement in American theater, in the avant-garde, that was like, we must bring down the dictatorship of the text. And the reason for this was that, you know, even now, 90% of the theatrical performances begin how? With a text. You come into the rehearsal room with a text, and the text determines the set, the costume, the light, everything, the acting. Everything is about making that text believable or livable on stage, right? So in the 70s and 80s, there was a great distrust of that. It was a dictatorship, that the text dictated everything. And so, of course, like every good revolutionary movement, we threw the baby out with the bathwater, right? So all of a sudden, there was no attention paid to the text. Or if it was peripheral. It was about the events, and this was the era of happenings, of avant-garde performance, of, what's the name of one of the NEA 4 who used to smear her body with chocolate?
Oh, yes.
Karen Finley. And I think that where we are at now in that conversation is that we're saying, no. It's true that the text has incredible power, but we have to find a ways of bringing the text into the theatrical narrative in a way that we can get the best out of all the possible worlds. And I think that's where we are.
The actors become the best dramaturgs you can have, yet most actors are left out of the collaboration. Why?
Because I think actors are the most underutilized artists in America.
Because why?
Because, first of all, because they spend a lot of time not acting.
Ah.
And second, when they are brought into the room, what they're asked to do is this much of their potential. Often, they're asked to do this much of their potential. Why can an actor go to Laramie? Why can an actor talk to somebody and bring back what they saw? You know, I am being filmed, right? That is one way of collecting information. But when an actor sits with another human being, they can gather that and so much more, right? Again, because what I said before of the empathy, right? So the body, the spirit, the mind of the actor can be used in such magnificent creative ways. I often develop new work, and I often work with playwrights in crafting their new plays. And whenever I enter a room, I always make sure that everybody in the room is going to be a collaborator.
Mm.
And so the writer, you know, there's that old thing. The playwright should only talk to the director.
Yeah.
The director should talk to the actor. But the actor should never talk. What the fuck is that about? Like, to me, that doesn't make any sense. Like, the actors have this incredible wealth of information about the characters that the writer is writing about. So I try to create a room in which they can talk. I create a room in which the player is here, and I ask her, is this what you meant? Like, we do a scene, and it's like, did that ring with what you wanted to say?
And the actors are there listening.
And the actors are there. And sometimes the player right at the beginning whispers in my ear, and I'm like, okay, for now it's okay for you to whisper in my ear, but soon I'm going to want them to hear it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, creating that room where it's so important. And invariably, actors are shocked that they're being asked to contribute their dramaturgical thoughts, and playwrights are shocked that they can talk to the actors, but eventually, playwrights are mostly shocked by how much they learn from what the actors say. You know, Jefferson Mays in I Am My Own Wife, he won the Tony for that performance.
And you guys, did you start all three of you together?
In that room, in a room with no tech, with no play.
Jefferson Mays and Doug Wright and you.
That's right.
And then how did that start with the set? How did somebody make a...
He did.
Yeah.
What ended up happening? Do you know how many of you have seen or know I Am My Own Wife?
I Am My Own Wife.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Great.
So I Am My Own Wife, for those of you who don't know, is a 70-year-old German transvestite who survived the Nazis and the Stasis and the communists wearing heels. Doug Wright had interviewed her and fallen madly in love with her and decided to write a play about her because she was a hero. She had survived the Nazis and she had survived the communists. and she had run for 20 years a gay bar under the watchful eye of the Stasi. So she was a hero, a heroine. Mm-hmm. And as soon as he started writing the play, the Berlin Wall fell, and the papers came out that she was an informant to the Secret Service, and that she might have been responsible for the imprisonment of people and the condemnation of people. So Doug Wright got really confused. How can I write a play about my heroine if my play is going to condemn her? And also the material was not entirely out. So Doug Wright got writer's block, and for 7 years he couldn't write a word of the play. And then the people at Sundance called and said, come, we hear you have these tapes that you have in this play that you've been wanting to write. And he said, I don't have a play, I have tape records and some interviews. And they said, well, bring a director that you respect and an actor that you respect, come to Sundance and play. So Doug and I had known each other for a long time, and we had known Jefferson Mays, and the idea of being 3 weeks in Utah in the summer was lovely. And I said, even if we don't come out with a play, we'll have a great time. Which is a perfectly fine reason to do something.
It's okay.
Especially when you're dealing with artists of that caliber, yeah. It's good to just... Anyway, so we got in the room, and my job was, how do you encourage a writer to write a play he doesn't want to write? And I thought, if we start from the text, he's going to freak out. So what I said is, tell us what you love about Charlotta. Hmm. Tell us what you love. And we spent a couple of days talking, and I said, okay, now we're going to use moment work. And each one of us is going to go home, and tomorrow we're going to bring a theatrical moment that articulates something about Charlotta von Malsdorf. And
she was how old?
By that point, she was 78.
Okay.
And so Doug brought a gay guide to Berlin, and he says, hello, my name is Charlotta von Malsdorf. I am 73 years old, and the Berlin Wall has fallen, so I want to see what gay life in West Berlin is like. He opens this and says, Café Anal. This bar is for transsexuals, trans... And so in that voice, a 78-year-old person doing that text was wonderful. So of course, so he read like 3 or 4 pages of all kinds of sadomasochist clubs and this in that voice. It was fantastic. That was his moment. Charlotta also collected furniture, and she had the most important collection of German furniture of the last century. And so Jefferson Mays went home, and he took up a shoebox and cardboard, and he cut out little pieces that he made into furniture, tiny pieces of furniture, like a sofa and a bust of Wilhelm II and a phonograph and all this thing. So he comes and says, hello, welcome to my museum. He opens the shoebox and he takes this sofa. When the Nazis came, they took all the furniture of the Jewish homes and they threw them on the streets. But look, this sofa is so beautiful. So I took it and I saved it. It has broken leg. I didn't fix it. That is its history. You have to respect its history. And gave us a whole tour of the museum using these little pieces. That was the second moment. And the third moment, my moment, was Charlotta never was a drag queen. She was a transvestite. Meaning that when you see pictures of her, she looks like an old Jewish man wearing pearls. I'm an old Jewish man. I wasn't that old when we wrote it, but I'm old now. And what I did is I was really interested in this idea of gender, right? Like, where do we place gender? And this idea of, can you have a hairy chest and wear a dress? So I found a dress in the costume shop there, and I got down to my underwear, and then I put on the dress, and then I looked up at the mirror, and I looked at myself with a dress and a hairy chest. And I read the text of hers the first time that she, as a young boy, put on a dress. But the juxtaposition of that text and me with a hairy chest looking in the mirror putting on a dress, there was something about all of that that made sense. Those three moments are in the final production of the play. And so what we did is we created, we spent 3 weeks, basically I joke about it, that I told Doug, we're going to spend 3 weeks not writing a play. Mm-hmm. Because I wanted to deal with his fear of this play that he had built in his head. Mm-hmm. And so what, at the end of the 3 weeks, we had a first act. And the first act was only the wonderful stuff about Charlotta von Waldorf. In the last week we were there, I said, okay, now we know who she is. So now we're going to start talking about what are you afraid of? And so he started bringing in the newspaper articles from Germany that were saying, shocking news, Charlotta von Waldorf may have been a collaborator with the Stasi. True or false? Was she responsible for the incarceration and death of many homosexuals during the last 30 years? And the end of Act One is that. And so what became clear is that the play that Zog had to write was really not a biography of a character, but a love story between a writer and the character that he's writing about.
In spite of.
Yes, and the whole dramatic center of the story is who is Charlotta von Waldorf? And Doug Wright keeps saying, is she a traitor? Is she a heroine? And how do you make those judgments?
Yeah.
You know, it was 2000, the year 2000 in America. How do you make judgments about what was happening 40 years ago in Germany?
Right.
So anyway, so that was how we used moment work to create
Fantastic. I'm so interested in knowing the difference, what you had to go through. Here you did the Laramie Project with actors in a theater. Now you do the movie.
Yes.
And now you are on location. You don't have chairs, the desk. You are in the location with actors who have had quite a bit of film experience.
Yep.
How was that for you? How did you navigate that?
Well,
the difference of that experience.
I think so much of the work of Tectonic is how does theater speak? That is different from film, right?
Yeah.
And because I believe that whatever medium you're working, you have to really pose the questions about that medium.
Right.
What can theater do that film cannot do? But when you're making a film, then you have to ask the same questions. What can film do that theater cannot do? What is the language of film? And how do you speak in that language? So, you know, the whole first four pages of the Laramie Project is people speaking about how much they love that land. All I had to do was pan the camera in that beautiful Wyoming prairie, and I didn't need a word. The audience was going to get the experience of that love. So it was about making that translation, and I purposefully, in addition to my company members, I chose actors who had a great deal of experience, because what I wanted was to pose that question about how can we capture the experience of the other.
Right,
so that's why we did.
But I mean, the first company you worked with, let's say, they interviewed the real people.
Yes.
So some part of the real person went into them.
Yes.
These actors now you work with in a movie, they didn't interview the real people.
True.
So when you were directing them, what was some of the challenges that you had to, for instance, face about talking to the actor about, let's take that again, and did you have to work much with helping them to not act, if you know what I mean?
When we made the play, we knew that our company was going to do it, right?
Right, right.
And that the exciting thing about that event was that the actors on stage had met the actual people in Larry. So there was going to be one degree of separation between the audience member and the people of Larry. It was like, it was me going, talking to you and saying, I just had a conversation. This is what I felt. This is what I heard. This is what I thought. We knew, because of gross indecency, that we wanted the play to be done by other companies. So we knew that our job was to create a play that in the text captured the essence of these characters. So hopefully the other actors, we knew that the other actors playing these roles were not going to go and meet
the people
that we met. So the actors had to use all of their empathy, not only to understand the characters that were playing so well, but understanding how to distill that into the words that were going to be in the page that was going to be the key for other people to make their productions. So when we got to making the film, there were three things that we did. Number one, we shot a lot of it in Laramie.
Yes.
Number two, I wanted as much as possible for the actors to meet the characters that they were playing.
Okay.
And number three, there were many actors who refused
to meet the people,
to meet the characters.
Yeah,
and I respected that.
Yeah.
Because each actor has their own process, and if they don't want to meet, but in those situations, they were always asking me a bazillion questions about the character. But here's the interesting thing. After we made the movie, I went back and listened to the original tapes. And the actors who never met the people of Laramie, the actors, the characters that were playing, when they spoke the text, they spoke it so similarly to the way the people had spoken it. Because the text had captured something profound about that experience.
Yeah. That's interesting.
So it was really interesting.
I saw the movie again last night. I've seen it before, but and that moment that Terry Kinney has when he's playing the father of Matthew Shepard and he speaks to the boy that killed him and he goes to and tries to keep from crying and then he breaks down, holds himself up again and then says, thank you, just like that, thank you. Very light. How many takes did you do of that? Or was it, do you remember?
It was not many. You know, do you know Terry Kinney? He's a Steppenwolf actor.
He's a director, too.
He's a director. And
brilliant.
He's a genius.
Genius.
It wasn't that many takes.
No, I bet not.
He was very fortunate because we shot that scene in the courtroom where that happened.
Oh.
So he was standing in the place where Matthew Shepard's father had said that to, you know.
May you have a long life.
May you have a long life.
Yeah.
So we didn't have to do much.
No. I just want to ask you about the tallest tree in the forest.
Yes.
So here you worked with a man who wrote the play and is acting in the play,
yes.
Daniel Beatty. How hard was that? Because he's the actor and he's the writer. So did he have a dramaturg as well as you there? Or how did that work?
We had the tallest tree in the forest is a play about
Paul Robeson.
And it was a historical play about his life. And so we did have a dramaturg, but the purpose of the dramaturg was to make sure that we were historically accurate. This man had such an incredible life.
Okay.
He met everybody who was anybody. So that was the purpose of the dramaturg. The difficulty with working with an actor who's writing his own play is just stamina and exhaustion.
Yeah.
Because he can only rehearse so many hours a day because the other number of hours he's writing. So you have to be, when you're working with playwrights and actors in the same room, they work at night and they work during the day, so you can exhaust both of them independently. But if you're talking to the same person, you cannot say you're going to write all day and then work for 8 hours with me and then run for 10 more hours, you know. So I had to become very vigilant to make sure that I was protecting him from himself.
This is my last question. What aspect of yourself has, to your surprise, become more accessible?
As I grow older, I become less ashamed. You know, I grew up as a gay boy in a very Orthodox Jewish home in a very Catholic and very machista country where the definition of masculinity was about this big. And so shame was a very, very early experience. And I think that my generation of gay men and women have really helped transform, I'm not going to say the world, but certainly this country.
I was going to say, what was more shameful, being gay or being Jewish in Caracas?
No, definitely being gay.
Yeah.
Because I was within a Jewish community. But I think that this generation will be remembered for many reasons, some of which are not so pleasant. You know, AIDS changed the, you know, we wouldn't have legalized same-sex marriage if we hadn't had AIDS. Mm-hmm. You know, AIDS forced us all to come out.
Mm-hmm.
So between that and the work that so many of us have done, I think that there's a way in which through a great deal of turmoil, we have earned some degree of peace.
Beautiful. Let's open it up to questions.
I've often said that, you know, for the last 100 years, there's always been this question, what comes first, form or content, right? And then Beckett came about in 1950 and he said, form is content, which was a really revolutionary and radical idea. And the way that we at Tectonic Theater Project have thought about form and content is that we want form and content to copulate, and we want that copulation, the offspring of that copulation, to be the work we do. And when we wrote that, we just were really giddy with delight at having the word copulation in our mission statement. We thought that was the coolest thing in the world. But it is an attempt to continue asking the question, how does the theater speak? Mm-hmm. Whenever we're doing a new play, we always think, what is the content? What is the form? What is the form? What is the form? And if you look at all of our plays, each play is in a different form. There are never two plays that are in the same form. And hopefully, the form of the thing speaks to what the thing is. You know, Gross Indecency was a group of actors around a table fighting with different versions of history, right? Liami Project was about people bringing a history from outside. I Am My Own Wife was the fight between a playwright and his subject. 33 Variation was the discovery of variation in music form. So you know, the example of Tom Stoppard comes to mind, right? The Ariel example. You know, can we keep asking ourselves to honor the art form in which we are living? We must honor our art form, and we honor our art form by continuing to push how it can speak in its most visceral way. I think that one of the definitions of moment work is a way of exploring the poetry in the elements of the stage. That poetry, the evocative power of theater, the metaphoric power of theater, the exquisite narrative power of theater. So yeah, definitely. We always talk about the poetry of the elements. It's always very organic. In Gross Indecency, we started looking at the trial of Oscar Wilde, and as soon as we started doing the research, we realized that Oscar Wilde would say, this is what happened at the trial. And Lord Alfred Douglas would say, that's not what happened at the trial. Mm-hmm. This is what happened at the trial. And the lawyer would say, no, that's not true. This is what. So we ended up with a series of versions of the story. And in our naivete, we thought, when we're done with the research, we'll know who's telling the truth. Of course, when we were done with the research, we were kept with a bunch of. So we started writing a play, and I said, you know what? In order for me to be able to decide whose version we're telling, I need to hear all of the versions. Yeah. So the actor playing Lord Alfred Douglas was reading from Lord Alfred Douglas' autobiography. The actor playing Oscar Wilde was reading for a variety of biographies from Oscar Wilde. Yeah. The actor playing the lawyer was playing for the biography of the lawyer. Like each actor became an expert in the character's text. So I would say, okay, what happened on the third day of the trial? And Oscar Wilde would say, I came into the court that day feeling very tired. Lord Alfred Douglas would say, he came into the court that day as if nothing was happening. Yes. And somebody else would say, he came into the court that day and I thought, I hope we don't ask him to speak, you know, all of these things, right? And so I asked the actors, because I was writing the play, I said, okay, can you name the source? So he would say, this is from the autobiography of Lord Alfred Douglas. Okay, page. And he would say the text, and I would write it down. Somebody else, this is from. And I realized that the drama was in the disconnect between all the different versions,
Which is how it is.
And people trying to figure out which version is the correct version. So the form of that play, a group of actors fighting with each other over quotes, is what the form became, right? So, but you're asking two different questions. So that's about the Uber form, right? But in terms of how do we organize the moments beat by beat, so what we did is when we came back from Laramie, we were able to, each person had become an expert in a couple of characters. So I would say, okay, what happened at the arraignment? And then everybody would say, oh, this happened, this happened, this happened. And we began to hear the people of Laramie telling us what happened in their town. So they told us what were the events that were important to them. And those were the events that we chose. The events that they told us in a room, in a rehearsal room in New York, that had been important to them when it happened. So it's always, we always try and build it in the rehearsal room. That doesn't mean that then we don't go away and we write for hours and days and weeks and then come back. But that conversation between what happens in the rehearsal room, how would it codify it into text and how do we bring it back, is very exciting. Well, I think that's a really good question. I would start by how do you get it to them? Get out of these rooms. You know, go to places where you think you can have an impact, right? The Laramie Project did what the Laramie Project did in Union Square Theater in New York, but it did something very different when he played a little high school in Indiana or when he played in a professional theater in North Dakota. you know. So I am always writing with the idea that I wanted to go to those places where the conversation can actually generate something. And in terms of how do you create theater that changes people's minds, I think you're going to spend your whole life as an artist trying to answer that question. And you're going to come up with a million ways of answering that question. The way that I have found to answer that question is that when you create work that poses questions of the audience and that puts them in a situation where they have to confront it, it works better than when you teach them what you think you know. Because when you teach them what you think you know, art becomes proselytizing and it becomes, you know, I think that all art is political, but I don't think that that means that you have to preach. You know, I think that, you know, Oscar Wilde said that art has a higher domain than politics, because politics usually addresses our basest instincts, and art usually addresses our highest instincts.
That's a perfect way to end this wonderful, wonderful time with you. Thank you.
I knew I was making an ending.
Yes, you did.